Easter safely.
Amen.
And I know he'll be with us through the storm.
Amen.
And don't worry about having to travel in the storm. I have enough here to keep you for 24 hours. I wouldn't do that to you. I just want to, before I start into the sermon, many of you may be wondering why I chose the song, opening song, and not many of us know it. But if you read the words in the song, it pertains to us in our relationship to the Lord. And even as Christians, we falter. So the opening word says, "We have not known thee as we ought." Boy, does that ever bring us into focus. We mean to. We start our day with him, but we get sidetracked by our everyday activities. Worries come into our mind, and we seek the Lord for guidance. Let's pray. Our gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we praise you today. You are worthy to be praised. Lord, we seek your presence with us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I ask that you hold me up, Lord, for standing here to give the message that you've given me. We ask these things in your holy name, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. I started out preparing for the sermon about 3 weeks ago. And we did it a little bit at the time. And I started out with the idea that I was going to cover the 23rd Psalm. But guess what? I never got past the first verse. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. This is a profound sentence. This verse tells us that the Lord, our shepherd, and he is alone, he alone is our Savior and our God.
Amen.
We can call upon him at any hour of the day or night. For he never rests. And that gives me comfort. Because our minds very seldom rest. Except when we sleep, and even then sometimes we're troubled. I want to turn to Luke 1. We've all, most of us are familiar with this message, but I want to read starting with verse 26. It says, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin. Crossed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be? Being that I have not been with a man. The angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And beloved, thy cousin Elizabeth, she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month. And with her, 6 months with her, who was called barren. For with God nothing is impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. It is evident that Mary believed in God. And it's evident that she also put those beliefs into practice. At first she was a little troubled. But once it was explained to her, she relaxed and received the message welcomingly. And Mary realized that she was highly favored. that the Lord was with her, and she was blessed among women. Well, a thought came to my mind when I read this. And I've read this story a few times, but this time the Lord brought this thought to my mind. It says, am I putting my beliefs in God fully? Or am I putting him on a shelf and taking him down when I need him? I think possibly I'm not the only one who's done that. When we get busy with our daily lives and we go forward, and sometimes we leave Christ behind. We try to do everything ourselves. We are to confess our sin. We're not to fear not. But with God, everything is impossible. We are to be submissive to the Lord as Mary was. And I say again, with God, everything is possible.
Amen.
James 4:6 says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Proverbs 16:9 says, better it be to be humble with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. It is clearly evident that the Lord cannot work with a proud heart. I want to turn to Matthew 18, verses 1 through 5. I tell you, I love our children's story time.
Yeah.
We hear innocent hearts praying humbly and thanking our Lord for everything that we have. I am truly blessed each time I hear their prayers. The Bible says that we have become humble as little children. Verse 18, starting in verse 1. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them, and said, verily I say unto you, except you be converted, become as the little children, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name, receives me. The world has it backwards. It teaches the complete opposite. It teaches that we are to obtain all the riches in our lives while we're on this earth. We don't need God. I mean, some may not come out and say that, but they're so busy earning the riches of this world. That's what they're telling God. They're not taking time for him. We are to be humble, not proud. God resists the proud. But if we become humble, he gives us grace. Jesus tells us in verse 33, he says that we are to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Verse 34 tells us that we're not to worry about the day, for tomorrow has enough trouble for itself, and the day has enough evil to deal with. But what do we worry about even the next second in our life? The next second. We're in trouble, we say, Jesus, I need you. And he comes that quick. A humble heart draws his attention. James 4:10 says, we are to humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift us up.
Amen.
Mary did this when the angel Gabriel explained about her being the child. And the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, will explain in each of our situations as we go through them now and later. Whenever the time is right for us to understand. Sometimes we wonder, where is God? Man, I've prayed about this for quite some time, and I don't see anything happening. it's not right for God to do it at that time, or maybe we're not ready to receive the answer. Be ready to receive that answer is spending time in His Word, spending time on our knees, spending time talking to Him. Talk to Him as a friend, but be reverent, be humble. Matthew 16, 24. I'd like to turn to the book of Psalms, Psalm 139. I found this a while back. It stuck in my mind quite a bit. We wonder why things aren't happening with us. Because we have hidden sins. Well, how do we find out about these hidden sins? Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24 tells us, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and I know my thoughts, and know my thoughts. See me, see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Pray that prayer. Now don't be afraid. The Lord will reveal something to you, but He won't reveal all of your sins at one time. You couldn't handle it. But He's a loving God. And sometimes we do things and not realize it's a sin until later on. I'm sitting here this morning in Sabbath school, we revealed a sin of mine that He's been called of. And I thank Him for revealing that sin, and I sought forgiveness. But that's what we are to do, to acknowledge our sin. James 4:8 says, "Draw near to God, and He will draw near to us." It's that simple. You want God in your life? You want Jesus Christ in your life? Open up your Bible. Get on your knees. Because He will come. He will come running. Be there in a flash. He knows our hearts. What we actually need is more of the come to Jesus moments. I've heard this mentioned in the secular life as a joke. "Oh, sir, have you seen the light?" Of course I've seen the light. That's why I'm here, to help you see the light. I'm going to share a testimony with you. Some of you know this story. But last September I had a motorcycle accident in the mountains. And nobody hit anybody. It's just a freak thing. Bike went down trying to avoid the van in front of me, which I did avoid. But I got broke up pretty good. Broke my right shoulder, broke my right ankle, broke my left wrist. And later on, I had a torn rotator cuff to my left shoulder. When I was in the hospital, I'd been there for maybe 3 weeks. Social worker comes to me and says, "It's time for you to leave the hospital." She says, "You need to find a place to go." I says, "Excuse me? I'm supposed to find a place to go? Isn't that your job?" Believe it or not, she was lost for words and she left. But it put Sharon and I into a dark pit. I've never been a man of great financial matters. The Lord has blessed me. Bless Sharon. We're alive. We praise the Lord for what He had done for us. Amen. We both started crying. It just felt like I was completely helpless. Completely out of any control I might have to start with. I told Sharon, I said, "Let's pray." We started praying. We're holding hands. As I closed my eyes, that pit got darker. I couldn't see anything. But Sharon didn't know this was going on in my mind. I was praying. While I was praying, this was happening in my mind. I had told the social worker before she left that, "What do you want me to do? Stand up against the pillar in the front of the hospital, which only had one leg I could stand on, until I die and the garbage truck comes and picks me up. That's when she left the room. So as we were praying, I felt the impression to reach for God. So I raised my arm. And as I was raising my arm, I saw a hand above me. I could see my hand. Some of the things I could see in the dark. And the message says, reach a little further. So I reached a little further. It says further. So I reached further. I felt like I was hanging on by my fingernails on the edge of a cliff. I felt the Lord take my hand. And I started crying again. But this time it was not tears of pain. It was tears of joy. Because I instantly felt forgiven of all my sins. I felt that everything was going to be all right.
Amen.
What an amazing God to serve.
Amen.
I had applied for two places to come to Rochester for my rehab. The one I wanted to go to was St. Anne's because I had both district places at one time and that's where I went. They were very good. But God always knows what's best.
Yeah.
He sent me to the Jewish Center.
Yes.
And I tell you what, they do an amazing job. 95% of the people just as loving and caring as they can be. He gave me the right people to work with me in my rehab. You see, when I got there, I fell on my right shoulder. And that's when I tore the rototuff. I couldn't even pick this arm up. I could barely move my hand. I couldn't do anything with my shoulder, but it was still broken. But praise God. You saw me raise my left hand.
Amen.
I never had surgery on the shoulder. And I praise God.
Amen.
To raise my right arm. It's only because of God. Not something I've done other than recognize Him.
Amen.
I can't praise God enough.
Amen.
Each time I think about it, it brings tears to my eyes. To know the Son that I am. If you cared enough to put me in the right places at the right time.
Yeah.
I'm not going to have surgery on that shoulder. The surgeon was very happy with the outcome. We're doing rehab. We were talking about claiming prayers this morning in Sabbath school. I believe in claiming prayer.
Yeah.
But I also believe that the life of Christ is also part of it. You've got to have that personal relationship. You've got to come humbly before Him and seek His presence and His guidance. Sharon didn't know exactly what I was feeling. All she heard was me praying. But she felt the same peace the same time I did. That's the powerful God we serve. The exercises that begin me was difficult. And when I come home from the hospital, I could barely get up the stairs. But I could get up the stairs.
Yeah.
As I was doing my exercises at home, before I started my exercises, I remember the text that says the Lord holds us up with His righteous right hand.
Amen.
Remember, the text that says He's going to be with us no matter what.
Yes.
I remember the text that everything is possible with God.
Amen.
I claim those Bible promises each time. Yes. I did my exercises, and in between the exercises, I claimed them again.
Amen.
He answered my prayer. He heard my prayer.
Yes.
And I praise Him for that.
Amen.
Turn to Psalms 40. verses 1 through 3. Psalms 40, verses 1 through 3. I love hearing the Bible's pages turning. Praise the Lord. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. He has put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear, and shall trust in the Lord. Blessed is that man that makes the Lord his trust, respects not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. I knew this text existed, you know exactly where, but I've read it before. I come across this text from the courage of a sermon, but I knew that he answers the prayers. I knew he was going to hear my cry. I knew he would answer it, for I was in that pit. I've been in that pit more than once. We all have troubles in our life. But I was in that pit when I first gave my heart to the Lord. I had a life of roughhousing and drinking and drugs. The Holy Spirit moved upon me and I accepted Jesus in my life. I sought forgiveness for my sins. I didn't call them out at that time, but I knew I was very sinful. We call our sins out to the Lord so that we recognize them. He already knows we sin. He knows what that sin is. But we need to know ourselves. And sometimes we can think it, but to hear it out loud, it does something to us. We have acknowledged Christ in our life. Amen. Amen. Return to back to Matthew. Matthew 1. This is something we only read at Christmas time, like the other text about Mary going to conceive a young man. It says, behold, the virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. I'm a living witness to say that God is with us.
Amen.
I go through a lot of, I still have pain occasionally, a lot of discomfort, soreness, but I know that God is leading and he's going to heal me when it's time to be healed.
Yeah.
Or maybe I'm going to have trouble with my foot for the rest of my life. But that's okay. Because I know Jesus loves me.
Amen.
We're going to trust Jesus in every detail of our life.
Yes.
Nothing is random in his kingdom. Everything that happens fits into a pattern for good to those who love him.
Amen.
And that's the catch.
Yeah.
We need to love him.
Yeah.
The first thing we do when something goes wrong is try to fix it ourselves. That's an instant thing. Oh, I can handle this. But guess what? We just might fail. More than likely, we will. We need to focus our energy on trusting Jesus. And at the same time, thanking him at all times, whether it's good or whether it's bad. Nothing is wasted when we walk close to him. Even our mistakes and sins can be recycled into something good through his transforming grace.
Yeah.
While we were still living in darkness, Jesus began to shine that light of his presence into our sin-stained life. And he continues to do that even when we give our hearts to him. Because we're born sinners, and we all need help. Can't do it ourselves. Finally, he lifted us up out of the mire. And I like to call it the bottom of the barrel. That's where I felt when I gave my heart to the Lord. He lifted me into his marvelous light. sacrificed his very life for us. He can be trusted in every part of our lives, every detail, no matter how minute, no matter how big. God can take care of it, and he will. Jeremiah 17 says, "Blessed is a man that trusts in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is." You gotta have hope in the Lord. You shouldn't just say it or think it. It needs to come out of us into other people's lives. Let our light shine so forth for men. That is what we are to do as Christians. These little things, sometimes, I know Sherry, one year, her and I loaded the back of the pickup with cold bottles of water. And we took some tracts to hand out. And we rode up and down the street to Rochester giving this water out. And they were like, "For me?" "Yes, for you. It's hot today." It was a very hot day. And they gladly took it. Sometimes they can't believe. I hate to say this, but sometimes in the city, in the rough parts of the city, they cannot believe that a white man is helping them. But in talking with them, I pray the Lord they saw something different.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, no matter what we're experiencing, God is with us. Just take his hand, trust and believe, and you will be given the peace. As no ungodly person knows, a peace of Jesus in our hearts.